Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the Q4 FY21 earnings conference call of Mazagon Dock Shipbuilders, hosted by DAM Capital Advisors Limited. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on a touch-tone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Mohit Kumar from DAM Capital. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you, Rutuja. On behalf of DAM Capital, we welcome you all to the Q4 FY21 and FY21 maiden earnings conference call of Mazagon Dock. From the management team, we have with us Chairman and Managing Director, Vice Admiral Narayan Prasad, and Director of Finance, Mr. Sanjeev Singh. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. A very vibrant good afternoon to all of you. It is indeed a matter of great honor, pride, and privilege for me.
This call is now being recorded.
To welcome you all to the for me to present the credentials of Mazagon Dock Shipbuilders Limited. As you all are aware, I'll give you a small short glimpse of what Mazagon Dock Shipbuilders stands for, and then we will take all the questions on your financial or otherwise sector. Mazagon Dock Shipbuilders Limited is the oldest shipyard in India, with inception in 1774, incorporated in 1934, and taken over by the Government of India in 1960. MDL is the only shipyard in India to have built destroyers and two different types of conventional submarines for the Indian Navy, and is also one of the unique shipyards in the world with such diverse range of products. From the time it was taken over by the Government of India in 1960, MDL has built 796 vessels, including 25 warships and four submarines. The first warship built by Mazagon Dock Shipbuilders Limited was commissioned into the Indian Navy way back in 1972, and the first submarine in 1992, which demonstrates our resolve towards Atmanirbhar Bharat and Make in India initiatives since that time. In commercial sector, MDL has also built 631 vessels comprising cargo ships, supply vessels, water tankers, tugs, dredgers, fishing trawler, barges, et cetera. Besides all these, 63 number offshore platforms, three process platforms, and two jack-up rigs were also built here. Out of these vessels that we have talked about 243 vessels have also been exported to Mexico, France, U.K., Iran, Yemen, Mozambique, et cetera. MDL recent deliveries are the Project 15 Alpha destroyers, INS Kolkata in 2014, INS Kochi in 2015, INS Chennai in 2016, and three Scorpene class submarine, Khandheri and above. Let me assure you, these orbits constitute the sharpest combat edge of the Indian Navy in both the fleets as of today. MDL's strategic location on west coast of India, connecting the busy internal maritime route from Europe to Pacific, and at the center of sea lanes of a commercial with rich industrial ecosystem and easy access to trained and disciplined workforce, provides strategic advantage over peers. As we are talking right now, MDL has a robust order book of roughly about 49,744 crores, which essentially comprises of four in number, Project 15 Bravo destroyers, Project 17 Alpha stealth frigates, and six Scorpene submarines, of which three already have been delivered. It also includes medium refit and life certification of submarines. With a strong future outlook as per our Maritime Capability Perspective Plan for Indian Navy and the Coast Guard, which essentially comprises of, we have already submitted the bids for about 2800 crores, which are largely to fructify in a horizon of about 1 to 2 years, which largely pertains to 3 cadet training ships requirement from the Indian Navy and 8 fast patrol craft and 12 air cushion vessels from Coast Guard. So these are the ones where the bids have already been submitted. Besides that, in the next 1 or 2 year horizon, we have another about 35,000 worth crore of orders for which we will be submitting our bids. Now these are the ones which are going to see the day of the light in the next 1 to 2 years. But the big ticket items which I am talking about right now essentially comprises of construction of 6 in number conventional submarines, which is P-75I project, which is costed at about 50,000 crores. And just the last week, the acceptance of necessity by the Defense Acquisition Council has been already released, and the RFP is going to be released in about another 6 weeks' time. So this is about 50,000 crores, and MDL is a very, very strong contender along with MESS L&T for this particular project. In addition, we are also expecting another big ticket item of construction of 5-in-number new generation destroyer, which is costing at about additional 50,000 crore. Now, these are something that I have talked about just now. In the export sector, bids worth about 1,800 crores are being pursued with Argentina and also the Suez Canal authorities for construction of 4-in-number offshore patrol vessels and 1 floating dry docks. So this is what MDL stands for with respect to the current order book that we are executing, and the ones which are there in the horizon, short term and long term horizon, which is there. Now, as regarding all the financial queries which are there, I would request to take your question and request Mr. Singhal, our Director of Finance, to address you.
Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everybody. Just to start with, the financial results are already out and they are on the net available. I presume ki these must have been examined and witnessed by all the participants who are present here. Still, for the sake of brevity, the standalone revenue from operations recorded for the year 2021 is 4049.69 crores, and the profit after tax recorded is 479.60 crores. As far as the revenue is concerned, there is a drop of around 18% corresponding to the previous year. Are you able to listen to me?
Yes, sir, we can hear you. Please go ahead.
Compared to the previous year, there is a drop of 18%. However, considering the pandemic period of we lost the entire first quarter, and the initial assessments were that there could be a drop of between 25% to 30%. So a substantial ground was covered, and the drop at the final stage is around 18%. As far as the PAT is concerned, there is a slight improvement compared to 409 crores last year. We have recorded a profit of 479.60 crores. You can start the question answer session.
Thank you very much. So then now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Bhagesh Kagalkar from HDFC Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Hello.
Yeah,
can you hear me, sir? Sir, regarding new P-75I tender, so the process will take some time. but then there is a talk that for speeding up the construction of all six submarines, let us divide the contract among the two vendors, L&T and Madhwar or Adok. That's just talk in media circles. Just as the P-17 Alpha was divided between you and Garden Ridge, essentially. So what's your view on this, sir? And in terms of margins, this will be a competitive tender. So what's your sense, sir, on this?
That's a very pertinent question which is being talked about in all the fora right now. The government approvals which have been accorded, we are yet to see the recorded minutes of the meeting which has been done by the Defense Acquisition Council only on last Friday. What they've approved is construction of six in number submarines, and there is a value which is attached to that one. And in that approval, they're talking about construction of six in number conventional submarines by one individual firm, which will be the strategic partner. In that, the approval is not there that there is going to be a joint collaboration or dividing between the two of them. But as what you have rightly brought in, current strategic scenario that pervades everywhere and the geopolitical developments, because any submarine, which is all six submarines by any of the strategic partners, whether it is Mazagon Dock Shipbuilders Limited and L&T. So the timeline which emanates is about 1 year of build. I'm talking about all time period after the contract has been concluded with whosoever is the firm. So 1 year is given as a time period for the preparatory period, and after that another 7 years to build the first submarine. So that makes about 1 + 7 = 8 years, and subsequent every other submarine has to be at a duration of about 12 to 15 months. So that is the entire cycle. So if you look at that way, if there's one company who is building all six of them, it is going to be that expanded over a period of time. But strategically, if the nation wants all these submarines, which is the requirement of the time, looking at the decade fleet of submarines that we have, in case they want to decide the top leadership of the government, then it could be divided into in some ratio. It could be 3-3, 4-2, 2-4, whatever is there, to accelerate the production. So that possibly could be there. It is a possibility which cannot be disposed of. But there's no confirmatory till now.
Sir, and regarding the margins, this is a competitive vendor, and also can Mr. Singhal comment on the pass-through clauses in the current order book?
It would be right now without the RFP, it would be difficult. Like in the current contracts also, there are number of components. There is a fixed cost component where the price quoted by the company is fixed along with the scope. In addition, there is a variable cost component, which is in respect of the items for which the specifications have not been frozen. And this is entirely borne by the Navy. So right now, we would not be aware ki what is the fixed price component and what is the variable cost component being targeted by Navy, or what is the level of preparedness at the with the Navy. Unless until the RFP is out, and what would be the buyer furnished equipment, there would be certain equipments that may be furnished by the buyer, that is the Indian Navy. So what all costs have been computed in this 50,000 crores, unless until the RFP is out and details out the broad scope, how much would be the fixed cost component, how much would be the variable cost component, what would be the equipments that would be made available by the Navy. It would be difficult to take a call with respect to the margins. And further, as the CMD has apprised you, right now it is the entire contract is proposed to be placed on a single bidder. In case there is a further refinement to this, or in case two bidders are there, then automatically the competition is not there. The pricing parameters would change. In case it is a competitive scenario, pricing parameters would be different. In case it is a nomination scenario, again the pricing parameters would be different. So unless until these issues are clearly placed before us, it would be difficult to decide on the margins and the pricing methodology.
Okay. And one last question on this tender, sir. The AIP partner means Madhav is ready to work with any other five partners. So we are working with Naval currently anyway for Naval Group for the current submarine. But for the AIP, what is the view?
For this air independent propulsion system, which is a niche technology and harbored only with few of these OEMs across the world, we have to just see the manner in which RFP gets floated out, because there are certain understanding of things which the Navy has been talking, and our entire visualization of the requirement is based on that. But the request for proposal would define the entire thing. As far as Mazagon Dock Shipbuilders Limited is concerned, we know Navy has gone. They had a requirement of an air independent propulsion system fitted submarine, which gives you a higher indiscretion rate and remaining dives for a longer period of time. So that is the requirement of the Navy. They have gone to five OEMs and shortlisted them with this capability. Some of them are in nascent stage of development. Some of them have already fitted there on the submarine, and they have claimed that they have completed the trials. Some of them are at the trial stage. Now, depending on what the RFP talks and conditions, whether they are going to accept even a land version trial or the one which is already fitted onto a submarine and the submarine already working in their navies, that would be the conditionalities we have to identify according to them and pinpoint our partner based on that. As far as MDL is concerned, we are willing to partner with anybody who has got a full developed technology and who would be sharing quite a few elements with us.
Okay. No, thanks for the reply, sir, and all the best from my side.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jonat Bhuta from Phillip Capital. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir, and thank you for the opportunity to ask questions. I have a couple of questions. The first question is more number specific. It would be great if you can share the breakup of the order book by project and the revenues for FY21 by, you know, submarine building, ship building, and ship repair, or submarine repair, sorry, whatever. If those breakups can be shared.
Yeah, broadly, right now we are running four projects major. One is 15 Bravo destroyers, four in numbers, which is the balance order book as on date would be in the range of 22,500 crores. Another is P-17 Alpha frigates. This is another four ships with us, three with the GRSC. As far as the MDL portion is concerned, the order book pending as on date is 21,500 crores. And P-75, six in number, conventional submarines, of which three submarines have already been delivered and major part of the order has already been completed. However, the balance order book as on today is approximately 5,500 crores. And another approximately 500 crores is with respect to one submarine, which is under
MRLC,
major medium term refit and life certification. So total approximately 50,000 crores. So this is the breakup of the order book. What was the next question? Could you please come again?
The revenue breakup, sir, between shipbuilding, submarine, and ship repair, if we can get that.
Based on these figures itself, it would be very evident that as far as the submarine is concerned, the portion remains small because major portion has been executed. So right now it is in the range of 80-85% from the submarine, from the shipbuilding division, and between 15-20% from submarine.
Got it. So my second question was, you know, given the current condition of the pandemic, do you believe that to have a continued impact on your ability to scale up revenues even in FY22, as you had seen challenges in FY21? Added to that, sir, is that since all of these programs that are there in the order book are nominated orders, we still not seen the kind of nomination margins that typically are allowed on to on these orders, which is about 7.5%. So do you believe we can understand that this year was challenging and hence we couldn't, as in there was not enough fixed cost coverage that came in, but next year onwards, do you believe that we can actually see 7.5% margins on EBITDA level with the revenue that you have, you're likely to book in FY22?
I would like to clarify, as far as the pandemic impact is concerned, last year we lost one complete quarter. Current year also, because of the severity, some impact has been there. I would not say we are losing out a complete quarter, but as on date, some impact is definitely visible. We have received, as far as the timelines are concerned, we did receive a four-month force majeure by the Government of India. We have further applied for another 3 months of force majeure on account of continued lockdown in the state of Maharashtra and considering the second wave impact. With respect to the margins, which you are stating the 7.5%, when we talk about 7.5%, we should not lose track of certain facts that this 7.5% is on gross basis. Subsequent to this 7.5%, there are certain provisions in the form of the CSR expenses, in the form of LD, in the form of other provisions that may be required in running a business. So the net margins on a net basis, they are never in the range of 7.5%. They continue to be in the range of 3.5 to 4.5% only. That is a normal acceptable margin which is available against a told margin of 7.5% or stated margin of 7.5% in the contract. The contract also has certain elements of execution or revenue on which the profits are not allowed, like in case of NRE equipments, which are developmental kind of equipments, non-recurring. So there are certain components on which these margins are not available. So on a net basis, the margins can range between 3.5 to 4.5%. In case it is healthy, it can range to 5%. However, in terms of absolute numbers, as the execution gathers pace, which based on the current figures and the current execution rate, we anticipate from 23 onward, FY23 to next 3 years, we would be reaching a peak on account of the overlapping of 15 Bravo and 17 Alpha. In terms of absolute numbers, yes, the top line as well as bottom line is likely to swell considerably.
Sure, sir. And last question, if I can squeeze in. Sir, like you said that every contract has a fixed price and a cost plus variance to each. So
it's not a cost, it's a variable cost.
Okay. So does the 15 Bravo and 17 Alpha also have that portion where there is a fixed price component and there is a...
Yes, fixed price component is normally 50 to 55% and the variable cost component is between 40, 45 to 50%.
Got it. Fine, sir. That is helpful and I'll come back in the queue.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Swechha Jain from ANS Wealth. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Thank you for giving me the opportunity. So my first question is, like you mentioned in a previous question, that somewhere between FY23, FY26, you know, we'll reach our peak revenue. So I just wanted to understand, can we safely assume that, we can do an 8,000 crore of revenue at our peak?
Yeah, that is a definite possibility.
Okay. And so my second question is, in earlier calls, you had mentioned about a new shipyard coming up at Navasheva. So could you just update us what's the status there?
With respect to Nava, we have been maintaining earlier also that although MDL has the required cash available and we are looking for investment in Nava, however, the investment would not be firming up till there is a clear visibility with respect to the future orders and requirements. As far as the submarine is concerned, even with this P-75I, right now the current yard at its present location is capable of handling 11 submarines at a time. And by the time these order P-75I gets certified and the execution starts, The existing order of submarines, six number submarines, would be definitely completed. So in addition to this, if other orders are there, large ticket orders, where the visibility is clear or reasonable firming up has taken place, then we would be investing, considering Nava for development.
Okay.
Otherwise,
so right now it's
a redundant facility.
Okay, okay. And so can I ask one more question, if I'm allowed?
Yeah, please.
Okay, so I just wanted to understand, like you said, Q1 was definitely impacted because of the lockdown in Maharashtra. So how is the scene there? And also, with respect to the commodity prices, we've seen a surge in the commodity prices. How does that impact our margins, sir?
Like I said, each of the contracts has a fixed cost component and a variable cost component. So as far as the variable cost component is concerned, there is a 100% hedging available. In case there is a rise in the costs, we are fully protected. With respect to fixed price element also, majority of the long lead items, the orders have already placed, have been placed in earlier years, and these are fixed price orders by and large. Wherever there is an escalation, some impact could be there, but in the fixed price, while quoting the price itself, these aspects have been taken into consideration. Globally, a significant price rise is not there with respect to the commodity prices till now.
Okay. So especially I wanted to ask related to steel. So does that impact our margins to a greater extent?
Or no, we don't see a significant dent in the margins.
Okay, okay. And so about how is the scene right now in Mumbai, sir, with respect to the lockdown and the facility here?
As we are talking now, we are presently fully 100% opened up from our operational requirements, and we are following all the COVID norms, and we have taken a special dispensation from the local government and local administration to commence our entire operations 100%. And it is intended, we have already delivered one submarine in the month of March to the Indian Navy, and we are trying to brace ourselves up to deliver one 15 Bravo destroyer named INS Vishakhapatnam by October, and maybe by the end of this year, another submarine. So whilst there has been an impact on account of the precarious situation created by this lockdown and also the stoppage of industrial oxygen supply, but all these have been by and large resumed to a very normal standard, and we should be able to catch up with whatever is there.
Okay, okay. Fine, sir. Thank you. So I have a few more questions. I'll join back with you.
Thank you very much, yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Dixit Doshi from Whitestone Financial Advisors. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity. So firstly, you mentioned that in FY23 onwards, 3 years we will see a good jump in the revenue. How do we see FY22? If I see from last couple of years, our top line is around 4,000 crore. And in balance sheet, we have advances from customers of almost 14,000 crore. So I assume that even FY22 should see a good growth over FY21.
As far as FY21 is concerned, we definitely believe the FY22 is going to see a growth. Right now, we started the year with better expectations. However, right now, I'll just say the FY20, we registered the highest revenue of MDL, that was 4,900 odd crores. As far as 22 is concerned, we feel ki we should be somewhere between FY20 and FY21.
Okay. Second question is, sir, in terms of this other income, so I assume that this is interest earned on whatever deposits or whatever advances we have from the customer. So it is by and large built into the order when we bid it for the order, and therefore it is more or less operational income only. Is that the right way to look at it?
Yeah, to that extent, as far as the accounting is concerned, you are right. This needs to be considered as a operational income, because this is primarily on account of mismatch between the cash inflow and outflow. However, just as a clarification, as far as the other income is concerned, for the year FY21, my other income comprised of a one major component of 160 crores, which was a refund of LD, which was withheld by Navy and which was under arbitration. So we have won that arbitration and it was decided in our favor. And the other income comprises of this significant component, 600 crore out of 600 crores, 160 crores is on account of refund of LD. And part of the other income is also on account of the dividend which we are receiving from Goa Shipyard. So for the year FY21, this was around 26 crores. Apart from some minor accruals on account of scrap sales and the likes.
So just to related question. So when you say that, you know, we have to look at 7.5% is a gross margin and 3.5 to 4% is EBITDA margin. In that we have to exclude the other income, right?
Yeah, we exclude the other income. That is only purely from the operating side.
Okay, so over and above the other income we will earn.
Over and above the other income would be there. And in our case, it is the right justification to consider the interest income at least as part of the operational income.
Okay. Thirdly, sir, if I see the current quarter numbers, on the cost side, there is a substantial jump in the cost of material consumed and procurement of bays and depot spares versus substantial reduction in the subcontract expenses, even though our top line is more or less same. So if you can just explain this thing.
Hey, this quarter you are comparing to which quarter? Are you comparing to the previous quarter
or the last year fourth quarter?
Quarter 4 of 20.
Yeah, quarter 4 of 20. So more or less our revenues are same, but cost of material consumed, procurement of bays and depot spills, these two expenses have jumped. And similarly, the subcontract expenses have come down significantly. So
these are the subcontracting expenses and the material costs. These are mutually compensating in nature. In case one of the component is going up, there is every likelihood the other component would be coming down. In terms of percentages, the cost of material consumed for the current quarter was 45% versus 35% for fourth quarter of FY20, whereas subcontracting was 2% in the current year and 6% in the previous year. So if I club both, it would be 49 plus 6, 55, and 45 plus 2, 47. So in those terms, it would reflect slight efficiency this year. However, I would not put it that way because it would always depend on what kind of equipment is going on board. There could be expensive equipment based on the technology. There could be equipments which are not that expensive. With respect to BND spares, BND spares are primarily bought out items in the nature of spares. These are base and depots as the nomenclature. And these are bought out items based on the naval requirement and clearance. So as and when they are procured, they are handed over to the Navy and revenue is booked. So this would always fluctuate depending upon the requirements.
Okay. One last question from my side. So you mentioned these two orders of 50,000 crore of P-75I and 50,000 crore of 5 destroyers. So I understand, so is it the understanding right that in destroyer, we will be the only player in the country, and in P-75I, only we and L&T can do this, and no, there will be no other bidder?
By and large, your understanding is correct. As far as P-75I conventional air independent propulsion fitted submarine is concerned, right now they are the two players as declared by the government. And as far as constructing this destroyer is concerned, nobody else in India besides Mazagon Dock Shipbuilders Limited has built destroyers till now.
In fact, I would like to supplement with respect to submarines also, although two bidders have been shortlisted. As far as the practical experience is concerned, only MDL has successfully two different types of submarines still did in India.
Okay. Okay. That's it from my side, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Venkatesh Subramaniam from Logic Tree. Please go ahead.
Thank you so much. The question was answered. The previous participant had asked us. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Keshav Garg from CCIPL. Please go ahead.
Sir, very good afternoon to you. And sir, wanted to understand that we have a contingent liability of around 45,000 crore, and out of which the major portion is indemnity bonds issued by company to customers under various contracts, approximately 43,000 crore. So what exactly is it, and what is the likelihood of some of this materializing? And sir, what has been the past experience? Did we ever have to pay something to our customers?
So with respect to the indemnity bonds, in the past, there has never been an occasion where these indemnities have been invoked. So with respect to the indemnity bond, these are being reported as per the requirements. We don't see any liability arising out of it.
Okay, sir, that is very reassuring, sir. And sir, one more, sir, question as well as suggestion, sir. Sir, since you know that our other income is twice of our EBITDA, sir, so, and we are keeping around 7,500 crore in bank. So if you could just transfer some of it in SBI mutual fund liquid scheme, sir, then we can easily earn, sir, 1 to 2% more. Should be around 15 to 30% of our net profit. Sir, it can increase just by shifting some portion from bank to SBI liquid mutual fund scheme. Sir, so you can please consider this suggestion. And sir, wanted to understand, sir, that what is the trend in the customer advances that we are getting, sir? I can see that in FY19 it was around 6700 crore, then 5300 crore, and last year 7300 crore of cash that we have, and against this it is basically other current liability, which is basically customer advance. So how is this expected to move? So from around 14,000 crore this year, so in FY22, what is this figure likely to be?
So we have not worked out the projections, but definitely the customer advances would be coming down. And although these are categorized as customer advances in the balance sheet, these only represent the stage payments. These are, technically speaking, these are not any advances not backed by a milestone. So whatever contractual stages are completed by MDL, we receive the stage payments against that. With respect to your first suggestion, we have just taken note of it.
Okay, sir, that is very great. And sir, just wanted some clarification. So you are saying that the customer advances will actually reduce, sir. I thought they will increase because that's been the trend in past 3 years, and also since our turnover is going to increase, so I thought that maybe the advances will also increase.
So against the customer advances, these will be getting adjusted with the deliveries and stages being accomplished. These advances will be getting adjusted against the contractual liability, contract assets, contract liabilities are also appearing. So both the figures would be reducing.
So basically our cash balance is going to reduce going forward.
All your projects, how are they placed right now?
Like the total contract value of the contracts which are running today was 81,546 crores, out of which 34,231 crores has already been executed. Balance is 50,301, which would be getting executed by 27-28. Majority will be completing by 26-27.
Sir, so basically, sir, like this year, 31st March ending, we had 7,300 crore of cash. So in FY22, sir, this amount is expected to go down or up?
Is the naval cash, the project cash. As far as the MDL cash is concerned, it is roughly around 1,000 crores, free cash.
Okay, sir, thank you very much and best of luck.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jonas Buda from Philip Capital. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity again, sir. Just touching upon this liquidated damages part. So, last year in FY20 or even now, we have a provision of almost 1,000 crore sitting as part of LD, which I think was provided for the P-75 submarine
program. Is for the submarines.
Yes. So, how is this likely to be liquidated? As in, there would be, do you expect A, LDs to actually be levied onto you, or you think that this will be written back? And under Ind AS, our understanding was that these have to come back as a write back in the other expenses rather than other income. So just wanted your view on why, you know, we've written back LDs in other income.
These provisions were created prior to the Ind AS setting in. So with respect to P75, this continues like this. What you are saying with respect to the accounting of LD, with respect to the current projects, that is 15 Bravo and 17 Alpha, this is adjusted against the revenue. So to that extent, your observation is correct. But because this was created prior to Ind AS, on which income tax has already been paid at the time of creation of the provision, so these continue as it is. With respect to the expectation,
now with respect to what is going to be the realization of this LDs, issue has already been taken at the appropriate level with the Ministry of Defense, and we are expecting a very favorable kind of a thing, because the entire, the as per the mechanism of the contract, when a project gets delayed, the attributability has to be clearly defined. Now, largely you have been talking about P75I, 6 in number summaries that we have been holding, the project 3 of which has already been delivered. And the first 3 have been delivered with considerable amount of delay. But on the delay, right now, the issue which is being discussed is of almost about 4 years and 18 days of delay. The delay which is being passed on to MDL would be just 1 month and 18 days. So this issue is under deliberation right now. Similarly, this I'm talking about the boat number 2. Similarly, boat number 3, 4, 5, 6 carry similar kind of conditionalities. And we are very hopeful that whilst this LD that we are talking about is very much pertinent, but once we give the explanation to the committee, it will come in our favor of the MDL.
Sure. And so this write backs or as and when clarifications on this are expected to come only once the 6th boat is delivered and commissioned? Or this will happen on a progressive, as you know, boat by boat basis?
This is likely to happen on a progressive basis based on the each boat delivered. Like till now we have delivered 3 boats, so based on these the dates and the data is firmed up data is available. So these 3 are under discussion. With respect to the balance 3, the provision would continue, and as and when the delivery happens and the data is firmed up, this would be taken up with the respective authorities.
Sir, this is helpful. Thank you, sir, and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Swechha Jain from ANS Wealth. Please go ahead.
I just have one follow-up.
Another 2-3 questions, maybe another 5 to 10 minutes.
Yes, sir.
Can I go ahead?
Yeah, please.
Yeah. So I just have one follow-up question. So with respect to LD provision, so do you foresee any new LD provision or any hit on LD related to, you know, delivery of ships in next 1-2 years? Because primarily because of the way things have been in last 1-2 years because of COVID. Do you see any new provisions or any new LD kicking in?
This would be a regular part of the operations. Like I said, there would be a delay of approximately 7 days, technically speaking, from the contractual date, of which 4 months has already been accommodated by way of grant of force majeure by the government. We have applied for another 3 months force majeure. So till the time that force majeure is not promulgated, actually available to us, a provision may be required based on the delivery dates. So these things kind of would keep on happening when the time extensions are available to us. Any provision, if it has been made, it would be reversed.
Yes, so can you quantify this? Like if we have to, I hope we don't have to, but if we have to.
In Bravo, I think we have already given a note in the accounts. It is under around 834 crores if you consider the max LD.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, sir.
That would be too theoretical.
Right, of course. Thank you, sir.
Also, just to assure you, I would just talked about the initial projects of the Mazagon Dock Shipbuilders Limited. Like, we delivered three number Project 17 stealth frigates, and they all had a delay of almost about 2.5 to 3 years. The first ship, the LD applicability was nil. The second ship was 60 days, which is about 46.12 crores. Third ship was 30 days, 23.06. So when it comes to delay, the delay attributability is not primarily only to the because of the Mazagon Dock Shipbuilders Limited. Actually, it is a luxury for the country to build ships with the defense PSU shipyards, because the customer, which is the Indian Navy, has created enough provisions with himself to select items under development. So some of a very large number of items do not fetch up in time. Similarly, as we move ahead with time in the build period of a platform, there are quite a number of contemporary developments which are envisaged. And state-of-the-art technology is there. Now, we have provisions that they give us the modification and also the time period to be undertaken. And accordingly, the right-hand side can be all extended. So similarly, we have delivered three number Project 15 Alpha Destroyer. They were delivered at a delay of almost about 3.5 to 4 years. The first ship incurred a delay attributable to MDL of only 11 days, which is 9.25 crores. The second ship, 30 days, 25.23 crores. And the third ship, 55 days, which is 46.26 crores. So these are the implications which are there. As what has been just now talked out by the Director of Finance, even in the current ship, for example, we are planning to deliver 115 Bravo destroyer by October. It was supposed to have been delivered by March. There's a force majeure already allocated by the government for a duration of 4 months. We are still falling short of 3 months. We have already strongly taken with the government of India that within those 4 months, the situation did not improve particularly in Mazagon and Mumbai and Maharashtra. It continued till 30th of October, and we could open up the shipyard fully only by 1st of November. So this argument has been put it across to them, and they are very proactively examining this one, and we are very sure that we will be able to sell our argument.
Right. So just to follow up on this, so if you could, help me understand. I'm so sure this must have been answered by you in previous calls, but just for my understanding, so how does the LD matrix work? You know, is it like a percentage or number of days or on the order value? If you could just explain a little bit, how does this matrix work?
It is on percentage basis with a ceiling of 5%.
Earlier, now it is 10%.
Now it is 10%. Earlier, the ceiling was 5%.
Okay. So this 10% of the value, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Dixit Doshi from White Soul Financial Advisors. Please go ahead.
Sir, first question was regarding this timeline for P-75I and five destroyer. So can we expect the orders to finalize in 2-3 years, or it will take more time?
When it comes to P-75I, we expect from now, where we are today, it's about another 40 odd days for them to promulgate. That is 6 weeks from the time that the DAC minutes are promulgated, is a timeline which is enshrined in DAP 2020. That in those 6 weeks, they will take out the RFP, and then they would give to both the SPs a time for about 4 months to submit their bids. And by the time, because this has got a field evaluation, trials of air independent propulsion system and all, but in rough estimate or in some kind of an estimate, you could understand, because there would be a shoot. I mean, all these five OEMs, their products are to be evaluated. So by the time an order is placed and it has to go through a CCS approval at the naval headquarters, benchmarking process. So this all should minimally take about 3 years for concluding the contract. And if 3 years is the concluding of the contract, you can presume that the first ship would be delivered from there on at an interval of about 8 years. And subsequently, at an interval of 12 to 15 months, every other submarine.
Okay, and similar timeline for destroyer order also, 3 years from now?
As far as the destroyer is concerned, they have still not taken out the RFP. We are hopeful, as per the maritime capability perspective plans of the Indian Navy, and considering the fund crunch on account of the COVID scenario and how what is going to be the geopolitical scenario development and where they want to put their thrust, the Navy would decide whether to put it on the destroyers or they have to put it more on the submarines or on the strategic submarine, which is the nuclear submarine. But we presume that some sort of a concrete picture would emerge only at an interval of about, I would say, 1 year to 2 years from now as to when they will launch the RFP. In regards to timeline, something would remain similar. This means once they take out the RFP, from there on, minimally about 3 years for concluding a contract. And these vessels also take about 6 to 7 years to roll out an interval of every one vessel at an interval of 1 year.
Okay, okay. Sir, how much is the total LD we have provided, which can come back as a, other income in the future years?
We have provided in the range of 1,034 crores, but it would be speculative on our part to indicate anything what we expect to be received back, because these are the issues which will be mutually discussed, deliberated, and the call would be taken at the highest level.
Okay, and one last question from my side. So, apart from these two bigger orders of P-75 and 5 destroyer, you mentioned that how many new orders we will be bidding over the next couple of years, other than this?
If you look at short-term horizon and a mid-term horizon, we have already submitted bids with the Indian Navy and the Coast Guard of about 2,800 crores, which essentially comprises of three cadet training ships, which is priced at about 1,800 crores total, 8 fast patrol vessels at 481 crores, and about 12 air cushion vessels for Coast Guard at roughly about 490 crores. So they constitute about 2,800 crores. And by the end of this year, we should get a clear visibility on whatever decisions they have taken on declaring the L1. Comes a medium horizon duration, if you look at another about 2 to 3 years, 7 in number next generation offshore patrol vessels, which is largely pegged at about 5,800 crores. Some 7 in number new generation corvettes, it's about 23,000 crores. High speed landing crafts, 1 in number polar research vessel, 1 in number survey training vessel, and an acoustic research ship for NPL Kochi. That these all estimated could be at about 35,000 crores. This RFPs we can expect and the bid submission within a duration of about 2 to 3 years from now.
Okay, okay, sir. That's it from my side. Thanks.
Thank you.
I think can we close? It's already 4:30.
Thank you. This was the last question. I would now like to hand the conference over to the management for closing comments.
I think as far as the MDL is concerned, we have already detailed out the existing business, the future business prospects, the financial position as it stands today, and the projections for next couple of years. It has been a fruitful interaction and certain good insights from the investors. It is a learning always for the management also. We are thankful for the participation. Thank you very much.
Thank you. On behalf of DAM Capital Advisors Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us. and you may now disconnect your line.
Thank you very much. Thanks.